Okay, everybody. It's 10 o'clock here in Amsterdam, and I think you're dialing in from lots of different places. So good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you're calling from. So today we have, a really fun session on the metaverse, right? The metaverse, one of these newer topics in the technology space that you probably heard of. And I'm guessing you're not completely clear on what it means and what the implications are. So that's what we're going to discuss today. Session is roughly 45 to 60 minutes, depending on how many questions you have. If you want a certificate, then please check the link in the chat. Let me check that quickly if it's still visible. But there's a link in the beginning of the chat where you should be able to find, and I'm sharing it again right now. So through that link, you can get your certificate. So you don't have to email me or call me, etc. After the session. With that said, let's dive in. I'll do a quick intro. And so this is me. I got feedback from other sessions that I should maybe do a quick introduction, and then we go to the topic. So my name is Rens. I'm the CEO of Kimo. Kimo is a Dutch edtech company that is now doing a rollout in India. I have a one-year-old daughter. I have a beautiful wife, and we live together in the Houthavens new neighborhood here in Amsterdam. So in my former life, I was a strategy consultant, both for McKinsey, as well as Purpose Plus, as well as the G20, which is a collection of countries that make high-level policy decisions. And I studied at Harvard, executive MBA, and also I studied psychology here in Amsterdam. Right, so background in multiple shapes, and I'll also make sure this webinar has that those different angles inside of the webinar. So it's not only tech, it's partly economics, it's partly psychology, it's partly technology, right? So we'll do a bit of a blended approach. So the content for today, we do an introduction. What is the metaverse? Why is it relevant? I think we need to start there, right? That's the beginning. But we'll then look at the market. So we'll see if we can understand where the money is going to. So you can see, of course, where most changes will happen. We'll quickly look at the technology stack, and we'll end with some open dilemmas, some big challenges still ahead for us in the coming few years. So let's start here, right? How much do you know about the metaverse? 1 to 10, open question to you. Just put your number on the chat just to get a sense of where you are now. I see 3, 1, 1, 5, 5. So quite some people saying still completely at the beginning, lots of ones. And there's a certificate link again. Yeah. Okay. Thanks for all the honest answers. A couple of people with 5 or 6. So there's a bit more knowledge, but a lot of people with 1, 2, 3. Right. And I think if you're honest at this point in time, then this is the story for most people. Doesn't matter if you're in the Netherlands or in the US or here. It's very new, right? So it's very lots of unknowns. And this is the situation where we are. Second question. And here I'm curious why you joined. Do you think this is primarily a risk or primarily an opportunity? And let me explain both of these. Opportunity, of course, you know, lots of new companies, lots of new jobs, lots of new opportunities in this space. But the risk is also, what if this is the next version of social media that is now even more immersive, maybe controlled by a couple of big players, right? So you can also see, I think, lots of risks in that future. So let me give you that poll here in a poll in Zoom. It's coming on your screen right now. So are you dialing in because you think this is a major risk for society, or are you dialing in because you think this is primarily an opportunity? Just be honest. I will not ask any further questions on this, but both answers are fine, of course. A few more seconds. And it seems we have an optimistic crowd ending the poll now. And let me share, right? So 94% of you have said, I'm here because I think this is an opportunity. So very optimistic view of what we're going to discuss. Thanks. Let's discuss what it is, right? So here's the first bit of complexity that I always really enjoy to debate. So what is the metaverse? Simple definition, as simple as I can make it. It's not super simple, but it's simpler than lots of the books around it. It's a network of immersive, persistent, multi-user 3D virtual worlds on the internet, right? So it's a 3D spatial version of the internet where you can walk through, be more immersed in than in the 2D internet that we have today, like the websites that we're currently entering. typically focused on creating a virtual synchronous social experience. So quite often it's about having social shared experience with other users in real time. So that's the simple definition. 3D internet, places you can enter, more immersive version of the internet, quite often social. But there's a bit more, right? So typically these worlds have a virtual economy. They will have a coin, quite often their own coin, or you can probably also translate that to Ethereum or Bitcoin. A permanent identity system. So you need to be someone in that world, which is then, of course, shown through your avatar, right? So you enter that world being a little virtual puppet that represents you in real life. In some countries, that puppet has to be linked directly to your personality. So I'm Rens. I create an avatar, Rens 16, right? But it can also be traced back to me. In other countries, that regulation does not exist, right? So the avatar could be there. It could be an AI. It could be a human being. You will not even be able to tell, I guess. And someone could make 20 or 30 different avatars for different environments. But anyway, there's an avatar, there's a person there, or virtual person that represents you. There's co-creation. So a bit different than the classic gaming market where the gaming company would make the world, now we are co-creating that world. And that world needs to have some kind of persistence, right? So if I plant a tree in my garden here in Decentraland, one of these worlds, then you should be able to see that tree, all of you, right? And otherwise, the tree doesn't have any value, right? So it's co-created. It has to be persistent with some kind of identity system, with some kind of ownership system or an economy. And how do you do that? You do that typically through a blockchain layer underneath that allows this kind of functionality. Last question, how do you get into this space? Well, you get into it either through your laptop, so 2D, 13-inch, 14-inch, 15-inch screen, or in some cases through your mobile phone, but still 2D, right? And in the future, of course, through XR, which is maybe goggles, VR, AR, MR goggles, right? So that can be more immersive. We'll get back to that technology later. If you don't know what it means, we'll get back to it. Examples of these worlds, Fortnite, Roblox, Second Life, the oldest one, The Sandbox, Somnium, Decentraland, right? So all of these, and actually the list is getting longer and longer, but all of these companies have a virtual world where you can enter into. It is still more complex. So the simple story, 3D spatial internet, where you can have social synchronous experience. That is the, if you need to explain it later to your parents, for example, then I would use that sentence. But in reality, of course, this is the future of the web. It's the future of the internet. So there's more to it. It links to gaming, right? Of course, if you start to make 3D environments with tokens, with an economy, then you start thinking about gaming right away. It links to social, because I already mentioned this is where people come to socialize. So is this new social media or not, right? That's also part of the question. It links to a future of the new vision for the internet, and we call that Web 3.0. Which is a new view of what the internet should become. And I'll go back into it later, but it's technically a version of the internet where you can read, write, and own stuff. So you would own your data, you would own your NFTs, you would own your tokens, where now a lot of that is centralized by a couple of big players, right? So it's a decentralized, ownership-heavy, more immersive view of the internet. And it links to tokenization, which is effectively rewarding people for certain actions, like mining a Bitcoin and your reward is, or sort of mining a block and then your reward is a Bitcoin, right? So it's this system where you can actually reward people for certain behaviors. There are lots of principles and philosophies involved, like these worlds should be persistent, interoperable. So these worlds have to be connected, right? So if you own something in one world, you should also have that same item in the other world. It should be decentralized, owned by everybody. It should be composable, so made by users. There's lots of collectibles, things you can own, right? NFTs, avatars, skins, pets or axes. And then there's the whole thing where it's linked to an economy, of course, to ownership structures and currencies. So simple story. And this is all the stuff that is, if you would draw a mind map, that would all sort of point to the same terminology. And the book here on the right, by the way, is the book where the metaverse was first coined as a term. It's like 32 years old, I think. And in this world, the story of the metaverse is pretty, simple and actually quite nice in how predictive it was, right? You have the actual world, the physical world where we live in, and you have a virtual copy of that world, which is the metaverse. And already that definition just tells you that lots of the stuff you would do in real life, you might be able to do in virtual life, as long as the experience is rich enough, right? So that's how it started. You have the actual space and you have a virtual copy of that space, which is then the metaverse. This chart, there's a reason why I want to start with it. So I tried to explain this concept to my parents, right? So explaining this whole Web 3.0 and the metaverse story. And the first question I got, this is all nice, friends. So interesting stuff. But why would anyone care about spending time in a virtual world if you have the real thing, right? So why would you care about this? And I think it's a fair question, right? And maybe if you're younger or you're already using this a lot, you think it's an irrelevant question, but at least for my parents, okay, fair enough. And here are a couple of the answers. And I think the first two answers are quite enlightening. So in the metaverse, you can overcome obstacles or disabilities that you have in real life. So everything that's possible there, that's not possible in your real life. And that's a lot of things. You can enter concerts from Ariana Grande or Snoop Dogg or whatever on your screen instantly without cost, right? Where maybe otherwise you would have to fly in, buy tickets and the whole thing. It also enhances creativity and imagination. You can do a lot of things there, designing artwork, draw in the air, fly over buildings, etc., that you cannot do in real life. So it's a place where you go to because a lot of things there, it technically allows everything, where in real life you have limits, right? So that is some of the answers that people are giving. Why is it interesting? Well, because of this. In terms of use cases, so if you take a more economic perspective, so you don't ask why would you join, but you ask what's the use case, where would you make money in the metaverse? So for the activities where people are comfortable doing something virtually versus physically. So you can see that 59% of the people said, I have at least one activity in life where I would prefer to do it virtually compared to physically. There's also people that like to do everything physically. Fine, right? And I think that group will probably shrink over time. But for now, that's the situation. And for the people that like virtual activities, what do you like? What are you really anticipating? And here's the top five. And if you look at the first two, shopping is better virtually. Right? Why? It's faster. You don't need to travel. You have more choice. It might be cheaper. So lots of reasons. Social events, right? So there's quite some people who like to be in, like what we're doing now. It's a social event, but it's virtual. You have also answers like, I like to exercise in VR. So I can, of course, then exercise in any environment I choose. Dating. I would like to date in VR or XR. And education. It could be more immersive and more interesting than the physical classroom. So a couple of use cases that are going to be quite big if you believe the users that are saying this. There is a bit more, and I'm going to show you also quite some videos in this 45 minutes to give it more bite, because otherwise you just hear me talking and we'll just see a lot of charts. If you look at software, right, and you look at engagement in apps or web apps, there is a sort of a secret that everybody knows that works in software. And that secret is you need to make things social. Software like WeChat or WhatsApp or Instagram, everything that has a social dimension has way more engagement typically, right? So people get back to it more often. Why? Because they have friends there and friends send them messages, and it's just a more attractive piece of software. So here's an example of a survey. If you were to start socializing in-game worlds, virtual worlds, metaverse, how would it affect how much you would play the game overall? And then 70% says, I would play it more if it's a social experience. And if you remember this and you look at the next video, I think you'll get better why Mark Zuckerberg explains the metaverse the way he explains it. Oh, 1 second. My sound is off. Try it again for you.
Are you coming?
Yeah, just gotta find something to wear. All right, perfect. Oh, hey, Mark.
Hey, what's going on?
Hi.
What's up, Mark?
Whoa, we're floating in space?
Uh-huh.
Who made this place? It's awesome.
Right? It's from a crater I met in LA.
This place is amazing.
Boz, is that you?
Of course it's me. You know I had to be the robot, man.
I thought I was supposed to be the robot.
Whoa. I knew you were bluffing.
Hey, wait. Where is Naomi?
Let's call her.
Naomi!
Hey, should we deal you in?
Hey. Sorry, I'm running late, but you've got to see what we're checking out. There's an artist going around Soho hiding AR pieces for people to find.
3D street art? That's cool.
Send that link over so we can all look at it.
That is awesome.
Okay, so by now I've tried to switch off the chat because I think there was some spamming happening in the chat. So I hope that worked. So let's review the movie, right? So what did you just see? And I think there it's there's a lot of little hints in there that are more sophisticated than you would understand in the first point. So it starts when Mark picks an avatar that he's going to use to enter that space. And he picks an avatar that looks exactly like him, so pretty boring. But he sees the other avatars in the room, right? And one guy is the robot, and of course has a more fancy personality. These avatars are typically NFTs, so they're non-fungible tokens, which means that they have some kind of uniqueness on a blockchain that you can prove. So maybe you're the only person that really owns that robot suit as an NFT, right? Which means it has a value, at least people think it has a value, and therefore there's a cost involved. And there's also, of course, the point, and hey, maybe someone has an avatar that's worth 10 million and I'm having an avatar which is worth 5 euros. Yeah, then there's like the real world, right? So you have money, you have identities, and you can showcase that in your avatar. Then they have this social gathering, of course, and his wife calls, right? And his wife calls from the actual world where she is dialing in, and it just moves in seamlessly, right? So the vision is this virtual and actual worlds will just become one thing. She points to AR art on the wall. AR, by the way, is augmented reality. So it means you can still see reality. You can still see the actual wall, but there's a virtual layer painted on top. And once that layer comes off, it becomes VR. VR is this virtual reality that you typically see with these closed goggles, right? So everything that you see is digital. There's no view on the outside world. So it mixes actual reality with VR, with AR, and everybody is an avatar with some kind of status in this world. Let's contrast this whole pitch to the Web 2.0. So currently what we're living through with our Zoom session right now, with Amazon shopping and whatever kind of websites you use for that, is all known as Web 2.0, right? We, at least a lot of the bloggers, feel that's partly or mostly centralized by a couple of big players like a Google or a Meta or a Microsoft. Why? Because they own lots of the traffic and even the hardware, the cloud compute and the cables on the seafloor are actually owned by these companies. So the view there is this is a centralized web where your data is sitting with big companies. You don't own it, you don't control it, and you cannot monetize it. In that world, people spend 8 to 15 hours behind the screen. Videos, social media are most popular. And most of us have a smartphone, so 6.5 billion of us, so almost everybody by now, which we check 344 times a day, which is once every 4 minutes. Gaming, especially for the younger generation, you can see that almost everybody is engaged in gaming, right? So Generation Z, 87%, is already in this gaming environment as well. So that is Web 2.0. I think that's already quite pervasive. So I would say that's already in everybody's lives. Maybe you have a couple of places still without smartphones or a couple of places without connectivity, but it's there for almost everybody. Let me take one sip, sorry. So Web 3.0 is the next generation of what we just saw, right? So 2.0, again, Facebook, Google, Amazon, everything we know. You don't own the data, at least you cannot monetize it, or it's very hard to monetize it. And the 3.0 is the read, write, own version of the internet, where you can prove ownership of NFTs, of tokens, of cryptos. It's spatial, it's 3D, it's wearable, right? So you can enter that internet through virtual goggles, through AR goggles, through suits, through gloves, and all these things, of course, are now being developed. Hopefully the control is decentralized. So it's actually owned by the users that own their virtual items and tokens. The organization for it, who is leading that? Hopefully the network is more important than the three or four big players. And what's the trust layer then? Of course, that has to be a blockchain cloud, right? So it's about ownership, it's about immersion, it's about experiences versus the 2D version that we have right now. Let's look at the market. So I'm a former consultant, so you can guess how we think. We typically track the money to understand what is actually happening. So before we go in, I want to tell you a little bit about how to look at markets in general, right? So if you start a company, you typically look at the market you're going to start it in and how fast that market is growing. And most markets, if it's hardware, for example, grow quite slowly. Maybe it's 2% a year, maybe 3%, maybe 5%. Right. And the same you can see in how fast that technology is improving. So if you're making milling machines, for example, how fast are they getting better? Like 2% a year. If you make piston engines, right, the engines we use in cars or we used to use in cars before it became electric, that typically grew at 5% per year. So they became 5% more efficient, for example, every year. If you look at technology nowadays, especially software, right, you see that is a very different growth rate. We see language models, which is useful for us in Chemo, grows 100% year on year, right? So they really jump every year to the next level, which is really different than anyone has ever seen in different environments, right? So this is very, very fast growth. And actually, if you look closely, it looks a bit like these S-curve charts. So there is a technology, it starts slow, there's a lot of R&D, and suddenly it takes off, everybody starts using it, and then it tips off again. And once that phase ends, typically we have some new kind of tweak in the technology that people jump to the next big thing. But overall, it grows way faster than other markets. And you can see that a bit if you just look at the last 60 years or so, you can see how fast we've jumped from mainframes to personal computers in 1980s. I still remember that when I grew up, I was born in 1984, and we had at some point one of these older machines that I could play with a bit. Desktop, of course, then we got mobile. First iPhone is 2007, if I'm correct. And now it's the last sort of 2D stretch where everything is, of course, cloud, 5G, or at least we're moving there. We have roughly 1 billion people now on 5G. And the next wave, the next decade is then, of course, this cloud, split the chip, 3D internet version that we're looking forward to, right? So with these growth rates, you can see very big jumps in 10 years, right? So for your kids, the new thing will be completely normal. But for us, that may feel like it's completely revolutionary. The market, so Web 3.0 today is very, very tiny. So there's almost nothing. You can see lots of companies jumping in. You can see lots of marketing for it, but it's still very, very small. But if you believe McKinsey report they launched 2 weeks ago, in the next 10 years, that will grow to $5 trillion. Right, so global economy, I think, is like $90 trillion. So $5 trillion is a very big, sizable market. And most of that will be e-commerce. So this is buying stuff in more virtual, more fun environments, which I'll show you in a second. But there's also a lot of education impact, a lot of advertising impact, a lot of gaming impact. Right, so this is the jump from 0.03 to 5 in 10 years is a super, super fast growing market, right? That's the projection. This is an example of that V-commerce. So you have e-commerce now, right? Which is the 2D shopping experience, and V-commerce is virtual commerce, or you have the goggles on your head and you can shop. And this is Walmart, for example.
Hi, thanks for visiting Walmart. I will be your shopping assistant module today, but you can call me Sam for short. Okay, let's get started. I have your shopping list loaded up, and I'm tracking your oil change so I can let you know as soon as it's done. You see the tomato sauce on your left? Go ahead and grab that and then place it in your cart. Great. Looks like you need a good wine pairing. Take a look to your right. Your age has already been pre-verified through your profile, so no need to wait for an ID check. Just place the item in your cart whenever you're ready.
Okay. Yeah, let me stop it. So that is it's a demo, right, for Walmart. I'm not sure if you like it or not. I personally feel it's still a bit low res and it doesn't look pretty enough to be really engaging, but you get a sense, right, of where this could go. So your car is being tanked while you're shopping. The system already knows what kind of pasta sauce you like to buy and what kind of wine you like to buy. It knows your age. There's someone guiding you through it. So there's a coach for your shopping experience for kids. There's also versions for kids to make it more fun. So they have little unicorns running around to get the right ingredients. So you get a sense of how this immersive shopping could look and feel like, right? And of course, the idea is the more fun you make this, the more people will buy. So that is the vision, right? So from 0.03 to 5 trillion in a decade. But the reality is, and here I plotted one new bar, which is the current internet, right? It's the 2.0 internet today. And you can still see that this is way larger than this current chunk, right? So realistically, yes, super fast growth, lots of use cases, but the real internet that we have today is still much larger than what we're envisioning for Web3. And this Web3 today, this 0.03, what is it made of? So who are spending money there? And I think if you look closely, I'll show you an example. A lot of that money spent is NFTs and real estate and these kind of things. Zoom is always a bit hard to navigate, but let me show you. So this, for example, is a setting where you can buy real estate. This is Somnium. It's one of these worlds that we discussed in the beginning. And in Somnium, you can own land, right? Same as in Decentraland and in the Sandbox and lots of these places. And if you want to buy this plot, for example, you can buy it through Somnium themselves, or you go through a platform. In this case, it's a marketplace, OpenSea. And you can make your bid, right? You can say, hey, I would like this piece of land. It's at the waterfront, so it looks great. And I will make an offer of, let's say, 5 Ethereum, which is, 10,000 euros or so, right? So that's how that game would work. You, by the way, you would never get it for that amount. That's a second matter. But that's the kind of ownership and money that people are currently doing. You can also go to nonfungible.com. It's also always a useful website where you can see the latest things that people buy for what kind of amounts. So here you see, again, NFTs, right? So you can prove the unique ownership. And this is not land in this case. These are pictures. So this picture is bought for 446K. This picture bought for 384K, right? So that's the stuff that is currently happening in that market. Do you like it or not? Is it maybe overpriced or not? I'll leave that with you to decide. But that's the current situation, right? So, and here I'm showing the same thing, right? So this Web 3.0 space right now, for large part, is these virtual worlds that you can jump into. You can see three here, the Sandbox, Decentraland, and crypto. And the pieces of land you buy there tend to be quite pricey, right? So they can be 16 by 16 square meters and cost 2 million, 1 million, somewhere in that. Sometimes you can also buy them cheaper, of course. But very expensive pieces of land. And if you own that land, you can then, of course, buy something on top or create something on top. So is this market, or this whole Web3 metaverse view, will that impact many industries? And the answer is yes, pretty much all of them, right? So it doesn't matter if you work in music or you work in tourism or you work in an office, it will impact what you experience in the next decade. So examples, music, there's lots of concerts already there. I'll show you one in a second. Fashion, you have virtual fashion companies. You have lots of fashion houses that are in these spaces already. Education, lots of schools already in the metaverse. Art galleries there, automotive companies there. You have real offices where you can actually work. Even BCG has an office there. Retail or e-commerce, I already showed you. And factories, I will show you later. it's also built by lots of different players. It's not one company building this like Meta. It's built by Meta, Microsoft, Apple, HTC, also smaller startups, Decentraland, Somnium, right? So you have big and small companies, hardware and software, everything. And you can make money in lots of different ways in these models. You can, of course, sell items, so e-commerce. You can also tax transactions, like your marketplace, like OpenSea, or you own the world and you tax everybody 2%, for example, similar to what banks, of course, have always done. You can have events, you can have play-to-earn, play-to-collect models. Let me show you the fashion equivalent, because I think it's fun to watch. It's started by a Dutch lady as well. I'm also Dutch. So this is a digital fashion house, right? And I think it's just one sector, right? We're not going to look at all the sectors, but this is how digital fashion could look like. And I think there is something interesting if you look at this. You can see that this is fashion without limits, right? You can design everything that you like virtually. It doesn't actually have to look good in real life. It doesn't need to be possible in real life. It doesn't even need gravity, right? So it can be anything. So this is an example of virtual fashion for virtual worlds that is taking off right now. And I think it's quite creative if you compare it to the actual fashion that we see. Okay. Let's jump ahead. So I'm telling you, it will impact almost every industry. And you can see now, if you look closely at the numbers, you can see this whole thing sort of coming up. You can see Microsoft buying Activision, the gaming company, for $69 billion. You can, of course, see Facebook changing their name. You can see Sony following, also buying gaming companies. And you can see the first big investment company starting funds for this purpose, right? Then Meta and Apple are both investing heavily in this space. Meta for a virtual layer, mostly software, and Apple for hardware, like the new AR, VR goggles. And all of these companies you can see here on the right are increasing their R&D spend, right? So everybody is now getting ready for the next wave, or at least preparing that next wave. And you see lots of smaller companies jumping in. So you see companies that make avatars on the left. This is called Genies, this company, valued at the billion, raised 150 million in euros, right? So really high amounts. And what do? They make avatars for people. You have fashion companies, as already shown, and you have also virtual pet companies that make a pet for you to bring to these worlds. So lots of angles to this story. And for now, it's very much a marketing pitch. You want to be there, you want to be part of it. And that typically happens with great speakers and great artists, right? So take a look at how it feels like to be part of a concert with an artist that is well known, Ariana Grande in this case, in Fortnite. Have a look. Okay, so curious what you feel about that. And I know the chat is switched also, so you can't express yourself completely. But what I'm seeing, if I see that, I see a very creative way of hosting a concert, right? So it's changing, the stage is changing, it's very dynamic. I see avatars, so you can join as a virtual you. These avatars have suits. Some suits are more fancy than others, and they have dances, and these dances you can also buy, right? So if you start, you have a very simple dance, but if you want a more fancy dance, of course, that could be an NFT and you could buy it. So it's that kind of experience where you can be there together with friends in a virtual environment from whatever device you use. Now, good example of where this could go. Have you mentioned a few times that you can jump into these worlds also through virtual reality or augmented reality. And this is the spectrum, right, that we're discussing. You have real life, which is your actual eyes, the world that you're used to. And on the other end, you have virtual reality, which are these closed, large goggles where you can enter into a completely closed virtual space. In the middle, you have something called augmented reality, which is where you see a virtual layer through look through glasses. You see a virtual layer that shows something on top of reality. And you have a very close relative, it's called mixed reality. It does the same, but it also knows where to showcase that in your room. So maybe you should showcase it on the window or on your television screen, and it has sensors to locate these things. So AR, MR, quite close, and then VR is completely immersed, right? So that's the spectrum. Those three together are called XR. So it's all extended reality. It makes your reality richer than without these goggles. And it will play a large role because it's the hardware you need to make this more immersive, right? Of course, you can enter some of these worlds on your mobile phone, but it's a small screen. It's not really immersive. But if you can enter it with no device in your hand, everything linked to your eyes, with hand tracking, all that stuff, it gets more interesting. So this is the market projection we see there. So now we know 6.5 billion people have a smartphone, but almost no one has a VR device, right? We're talking 11, maybe 30 million people that have such a device, which is just really, really small still. But we think that will go up very quickly in the coming years. Why? Because the quality is getting better very quickly and the prices are dropping very fast. So now Oculus Quest, you can buy it for 300 euros. Yes, it's a lot of money, but it's a third or a fourth of what your iPhone would cost, right? So they become affordable, they become better quality, and therefore we think at some point they will flood the market when the device is good enough. The big moment is, when is that going to happen? Because of course, some people think you need a killer app, like you need one app that everybody likes, and then suddenly those devices will kick in. Other people think, well, it's when Apple launches their new AR VR device, which we know is not too far away, right? So you have these moments, maybe it's a big company jumping in, maybe it's really great software, but this is the projection that most people use. Where is it going? So what does it mean for you? Because I know you probably have a TV, maybe you have a laptop, maybe you have a tablet, maybe you have a smartwatch, you probably have a phone, right? So you have lots of different screens. And where we think that we'll move to is to a situation where you only have one screen. And that one screen, of course, is one pair of goggles that could mimic any screen that you like. So whether you like to have a television or a cinema or a smartwatch, that goggle could impersonate that particular device. So we're thinking that all these screens will merge into one. That's a pair of goggles that can handle both AR and VR at the same time. And let me show you how that looks like.
So this is kind of where we see things going in, you know, 5-7 years. A device that becomes AR when you want to augment something, it becomes opaque. It becomes VR when you need it, when you need to travel to a different place or to a different world, right? And it's light and something that you can carry and wear with you all day. You might think, oh, that's really far away. What is it going to look like in the next couple of years? This is what we kind of think it's going to look like. A device that you put on, it might have cameras in the front that then scans your room, turns every wall, every piece of furniture into a virtual object, and I can put virtual screens on and be able to project. So I don't remember who said that, you know, it's going to replace all the screens and all the TVs on your house. Absolutely, that's going to happen. In fact, it's going to replace all the windows that you have and let you have a different view. You know, this particular child is playing a game where his wall is now the bottom of a dungeon, right? That's possible in technology today.
Okay, so what did, this is Alvin, right? Alvin is the head of China for HTC. HTC is a hardware company, heavily invested in this metaverse space. And then what he's showing is, in the beginning, you put on these glasses and it's an MR experience, right? It's mixed reality. So only specific items on the wall change shape. And then at some point, the kit triggers the button and it becomes a VR because it becomes completely immersive, right? So he's showing a pair of goggles that can do both at the same time and just change shape based on what's necessary. And let me jump into a couple of questions that I see here in the chat. So so the chat is turned off. How would new tech deal with raising privacy and data security issues in the metaverse? So Spandan is asking that question. It's a very deep question, because there are lots of complications, right? So the first thing is this going to be a centralized situation where you have big tech making this, collecting all the data on your behalf, or is this going to be a decentralized situation where, for example, that data that you produce would actually be owned by you? In that case, of course, it's a different story than if it's owned by a company. So that is the big open question here that's currently not answerable. We all hope it's going to be decentralized. Realistically, it has always been centralized in practice, right? But it's a good point, because if you wear more of these technology items like VR, AR goggles, they have a lot of sensors, right? So they will produce real-time data, sensors on the outside and sensors on the inside. So they will know your emotional state. They can infer your emotions. They can infer eyeball tracking. They can infer quite a lot of things from where you are, what you're doing, how you're feeling. So it would lead to a more real-time data stream, bigger than what we already have with these 2D devices. So there is a large opportunity in collecting all these real-time, also social data streams. And I think it's hard to say how that will play out now. The big question under the hood is decentralized structure or centralized. Can be a bit louder. I hope I'm loud enough. Is it like creating a virtual mirror world? Defrance is asking. And I think the answer there is yes. So with a couple of nuances, right? So yes, this is a virtual copy of reality, but of course you don't have the limits of reality, right? So everything that's not possible in real life might be possible here. So in real life, if you jump off a building, you probably die. There, if you jump off a building, you probably don't, right? So it's that copy with lots of similarities, but also way more creativity, I expect, because you don't have those same limits. Can it be used for educational purposes? Manpreet, I think that is my big hope. So I'm in education. I care a lot about education. And I think this virtual get together is the perfect solution for education for a lot of reasons, right? But the big thing is it can make you, let's imagine you learn history, for example, and you want to understand a particular phase. With this technology, you can actually enter the room, be there, make it more immersive, make it more real, make it more emotional. So you actually remember it instead of reading it from a 2D textbook or screen. So I think this is a great opportunity to make education more immersive, more memorable, and more exciting. What are the dangers of the metaverse? Mohammed is asking. I'm not sure how much time we have, but there are many dangers. Mohammed, if it's okay with you, I'll point you to a couple of them at the end of the session. Here, and Spandan is indeed, so he's already saying, if the metaverse run platforms like hand and facial gestures for usage and store data like biometrics and fingerprints, wouldn't that compromise the privacy and security of users? So potentially, yes, right? So I think the short answer is there will be way more data available. There will be way more real-time data available. And the question is, who's capturing that data? And if we can change the structure, the ownership structure, to personal ownership, or that would actually still rest with centralized players. Maybe I'll do one more question. NFTs. So Arpit is asking, people say the music NFTs hype is very temporary, just another trend, and the hype will go down soon. What do you think? And I think we should have a look at that particular area. So NFTs, right? In short, NFTs stand for non-fungible tokens. Tokens, by the way, are typically smart contracts that you run on top of a blockchain. So a contract is of course some kind of agreement that you can execute automatically, because it's a script, right? So it's not too complex. It's sort of like an if-then contract without too many nuances, but it's a blockchain smart contract based system where you can provide rewards to people. And an NFT, so non-fungible token, is a token which is unique and is scarce, right? So let's say you have the picture of the monkey we just saw before, like the ones you see here in the middle. If you own that NFT, typically that means you own the original item of that picture, right? We know it's virtual, digital, right? So you could copy paste that, control C, control D, for example, and you have a copy of that, but it's not the original item. So the logic here is, if you want to own the original art or the original music song or the original video, you could make it into an NFT. You mint that to a platform like OpenSea, proving that you are the creator, and then people can buy that and become the original owner. That's the logic. Do I believe in that personally? No, not really, but I'll leave that up to you. So here on the left, you have an example of artwork sold for 92 million. Here is an artwork sold for 69 million, right? So this is a picture that was designed by someone that someone else paid that amount for. You also have whole collections of pictures. You have Bored Apes, Crypto Kitties, lots of those examples. And here on the right, you can see a trend, and I think the trend is quite telling. These are the virtual wallets that people carry around, right? A virtual wallet is like a real wallet where you can store the stuff that you own, but this time it's virtual. It typically sits in your Chrome browser or another browser, right? And it stores your NFTs or tokens or cryptos. A little warning, if you use those wallets, right, it's not linked to your government. It's not linked to your bank. So if you lose your password, you lose everything, right? It's purely your wallet. If you lose access, however many NFTs you have, it's gone. But it's a virtual wallet that you own and you control. This is the 69 million piece. This is the Beeple everyday artwork. And so this was bought, the original one, for 69 million. And let me ask you this question. Now that you know a bit about NFTs, you know what they represent, so scarce, unique, in this case, digital items, would you buy this artwork for 5 million today? Let's say I have it. Let's say I can offer it to you at a really good discount because it was 69 million. Now it's only 5 million. And my question is, would you take it or would you leave it? So let me pose that question. I know you're very optimistic about the metaverse, but now would you like to invest? I'm guessing for most of you, $5 million is a lot of money. So you need to go to the bank together with the family, get the mortgage. It's going to be a hassle. But then, you know, it's $64 million less than the former price. So curious if you believe enough in this to buy. Okay, let's end the poll. And if I'm correct, last time we had a 94% people saying, I'm very optimistic about this. Now we have a different result. So now we have 43% of you saying that, yes, I would buy this, which I think fair enough, right? So there's a significant group here saying I would go for that. And 57% saying that, no, that's not for me. So now it gets a bit more complex. Now you have to put real money in and see if you believe or not, right? But that's the NFT situation. Is it temporary or not? Hard to say. What you can say is that people are willing to pay for these things and the market is there. So from a factual perspective, you can say, well, the market seems to be there. How long will it last? I'm not sure. The reason I'm more skeptical, I'll just share that. It's not investment advice or anything. But typically, if you invest in something that will generate future cash flows, right? And you can then calculate how many cash will come back in which years, etc. And then you can make some kind of reasonable estimate about what the amount should be that you're paying. And this for me is there are no future cash flows. So it's speculative. I would argue since there are no cash flows, there's no actual value to be expected unless it increases, but that's speculation. So for me, therefore, it's not that attractive. But that's my logic based on my background. Okay, what is interesting, whether you like this or not, right? I'll leave it to you. But what is interesting here is the logic underneath, right? So how do you trust people on the internet? Has always been difficult since day one. The last thing we tried, of course, was in shopping platforms, you have these 1 to 5 star ratings. But now that is, of course, shifting due to blockchain, because you can see transparently every transaction from A to B. So you can prove that something has happened and that you now own something as the unique owner. You have that in your virtual wallet. It's traceable on this virtual decentralized ledger, right? Which you should read a bit like an Excel sheet with all the transactions that is stored on lots of different computers at the same time. So it can be verified by lots of people because it's transparent and it's stored decentrally. So I think this is critical, right? This is a new trust mechanism for the web that you can use for NFTs, you can use for crypto, you can use for lots of different things, for items you have in metaverse environments, etc. It's all the same logic, right? So you don't need the bank, you don't need the government. So whether you want to buy and invest in it or not, but the logic here is the key to understand. And practically speaking, so what is the market, right? Final part on the market. Where is it currently really useful? Well, it's useful for training people, educating people. So here you see special forces that, of course, is hard to do in real life, that training, so they do it virtually. You see surgery practice, which is, of course, also hard to do in real life, but you can do that virtually. You have lots of shopping applications already. So in China, some of these things are already live. On the right is IKEA, which is this classic Nordic furniture store we have in Europe. You can buy a couch, for example, or a chair, and with AR, place it in your room with your smartphone. So you can see how it looks like. So that's already on the market, right? Has been there for a couple of years already. And then there's lots of cool applications of where this is already used in engineering. So if you're dialing in and you have an engineering future ahead of you, right? Lots of use cases where these kind of things are directly relevant for robot repair, engine repair, designs, etc. And I want to show you this because it takes it a bit away from the gaming aspect, where everything is sort of fun and gaming, to the actual manufacturing hardware aspect.
トラブルって言ったものをよ予兆って言ったものに気づけると考えております。遠隔地の方のエキスパートの方がいてくれるだけで、一つの作業現場に技術力であったり知見って言ったものを流すだけではなくて、複数の作業場って言ったところに提供しまして、そうすることによって即時にトラブルシュートを迅速化できます。それがデジタルツインの世界ができますと、実際現場に行かなくてもそのトラブルの状態が手に取るように分かって、そこでもう直すことができると。
まあそういったものがですね、仮想空間の中で全部調べれるようになります。完全なるメタバースの世界は開発から設計ないしは試験までの全ての工程っていうものを仮想環境上で実行できます。Okay,
so I'm not sure if you fully understand what you're seeing. It's a little bit complex maybe, but the cool thing is they're showing an AR application, which is these goggles that the lady uses to inspect the robot. And what she's seeing is way more data that is floating around on top of the robot about the state of the robot, right? Temperature, different sensors on pressure and all these kind of things. So it's much easier to understand how your robots or how your factory is doing because the data is all there based on sensors, of course, inside the machines. The second part is where what you see now on the screen still is where this whole entity, this whole robot is now a virtual twin of that robot. And it's the same thing that we do with cars nowadays. It's the same thing some companies are doing with entire factories. So they have virtual copies of these machines that they can optimize virtually before they try optimizations in real life, right? So this is the game here. You're trying to optimize, tweak the system in a virtual metaverse environment before you do that in real life. Okay. So thanks for sticking with me. We covered the market. The rest is going to be way quicker, and we also have only a few minutes left. So I will not go into all the details. You'll get the slides 10 minutes from now. So after we're done, I'll send them over. But I want to point to how this game is actually going to work, and also what are the risks still, right? So in the last few minutes. This is the full stack, or a picture of the stack of how this will actually need to work. So if you want to build this, obviously you need to have a trusted layer that everybody can rely on. That could be the blockchain, and it probably will be the blockchain, but the question is still which blockchains are most efficient. As we know, a lot of blockchains are computationally not efficient enough, and therefore, for example, in carbon dioxide levels, they're not that attractive. Right, so we might need more efficient Solana kind of blockchains that can really do this at a large scale. You need the right hardware, of course. You need cloud computing centers that do most of the computation, because the devices that you're going to carry around will probably not have the chips to really do that computation. So we call that split the chip, where some of the work is done on your device and most of the work is done in the cloud. And for that, you need, of course, a 5G or 6G connection to make that real time. You need shared standards and protocols, right? So people, for things to talk to one another, that needs to be aligned. You need payment technology that works, and you need regulation. And especially regulation, I think we're still up in the air on how that will look like. Then you get to this whole principle layers that we already discussed. Are these worlds going to talk to one another? Are they going to be interoperable or not? Will they be persistent? Will they be decentralized? Will they use the same rules, or will everybody do their own stuff? Then you have the whole content creation layer. So who's making the content? Are that gaming companies, or are that individuals like you and me that are mostly involved? And which marketplaces will then dominate? And then you get to this major question, how many of those worlds will in the end survive? Maybe the Meta world, maybe the Apple world, and maybe something else, or will there be hundreds of them? And of course, then you have the experiences that you can have, right? You can socialize, you can play, you can work, etc. So that whole stack, that's how I look at it in terms of the complexity there. For every item, you could go, of course, really deep into what it really means. But if you look at this, then you get to at least three, and I'll end the session with those three open questions to keep you thinking about this for a bit, at least a couple of big issues that we still need to solve. So on this one, you know, there's probably going to be more than one of these worlds. Already there are more than one of these worlds. So will they be able to talk to one another? So if I buy a virtual item in one world, can I bring it to the other world? And if the answer is no, should we force those companies to allow that? Or do we think they will do that because users like you and me would like that? Right? It's a big open question. Most people would say that they should be interoperable. So if I buy an NFT for 5 million in this world, then I want to use that NFT also in another world. Otherwise, it's not worth the 5 million. So that logic, I think, is sensible. But if you look at the classic history of software, then most worlds don't really talk so well to one another, because the company would like you to be inside their world and not move somewhere else. So big open question, maybe because of regulation, maybe because companies will better their lives, or maybe because users will really demand it, or maybe it will never happen. Then there's the whole thing of how do you make sure people behave nicely, right? We had a couple of spamming messages here on the chat, and this is just a simple Zoom call, right? And we have no one, by the way, to regulate it. I'm by myself. But this will happen on a very large scale if you go into a metaverse environment. What happens if you have a couple of 100,000 users there? Maybe some people harass other people. There could be lots of small crimes and things going on. So how do you make sure that does not happen? And who does that? Is that the software company who's responsible for putting this into code? Or is that another kind of agency that makes regulations that's then done by the software company? At the moment, we don't have that answer, right? Meta is trying to do some stuff on their own. They've also been trying to do that, of course, forever with Facebook. It hasn't worked so well, right? So this whole open question is, how do you police these roles? What are the rules and who's enforcing the rules? Completely unclear. And the last thing, because I know you are all optimistic about what can happen here and can you make money here? And I think the answer is yes, you can. There's lots of different job opportunities in these spaces. But what kind of rules do apply? If you go to an employer, you typically have a contract. You typically are paid in the currency of your country, and you typically pay taxes in that currency to your government, right? In this case, that should not necessarily be the case, right? You have a wallet, which no one knows about, your government cannot see. You might be paid in crypto, you might be paid in NFTs. You probably don't have a contract. You probably don't have workers' rights, because you don't even know who the HR director is for the company that you work for, right? So it could be a very different experience where lots of the rules that you're used to or that you're expecting are simply not there because they're not tested and regulated. So I'm not saying don't try this. I think it's interesting to try, but I would say be a bit careful with how the rules actually work out. So far, it's 11 sharp. So we made it through. Let me do one or two questions at the end if you're still. So Krishna is asking which language is used for virtual base world metaverse. I think you mean coding language, Krishna. So you have, I think in practice, of course, it's a whole stack of things, but mostly I would say these worlds have SDKs. So you don't need to go into Unreal or Unity or something like that. You can, of course, right? If you want to go further, you can jump into those sort of 3D gaming languages that they use a lot. But quite often they have SDKs that make it quite easy to build something. If you want to go into blockchain, it's Solidity, of course, right? So there's a language for that as well. But that is more the ground layer of the whole system. What is the actual use of NFTs? Very good question. I think, Devansh, NFTs represent scarce, unique items, right? So there are more use cases than one. But given the scarcity and the uniqueness, you can change, by the way, you can put everything into an NFT. Technically, you could take this iPhone and make 10 NFTs of it, and that represents then the unique ownership of my iPhone. So you might even link it to physical items if you like, but also to music, songs, or to videos online, or to this webinar we could make into an NFT, right? So the main use case is sell or buy something that is unique, but that could still be anything, and it could also be divided in parts. Can we use photographs as NFTs? I think you can. Of course, they would always check if the photograph really belongs to you and if there's no people inside that photograph that have not agreed to it, but technically I think you can. Do I need money to mint my own NFT? Yes, you need some money as gas fees to mint your NFT. I'm not sure how much, 20 or 30 euros or so, and I think you should be there. Okay, guys and girls, thanks so much for joining. I hope you learned something. I hope you at least got your world shaken a bit by all this new stuff that's coming. And I hope to see you again in the future session. Thank you.